All right, guys, welcome. Another day, another interview. I met him in the Pearl of West Flanders, where he has his own malt bakery. So he's not a brewer, but sometimes he takes the airplane around the world to install or to fix brewery installations. Welcome, Bert van Hikke. How are you doing?
Good evening. Hello. I'm doing fine. Thank you.
Tell me a bit. You have your own malt bakery. What was the idea behind that?
So the idea behind it was when I started my business, I wanted to do something different. I wanted to create something no one was doing at that moment, because I was scared that Belgian beer in the future will not be like the same as it was before, because in the past people bought Belgian beer because it was from Belgium. And I thought, let's add some new level to it. Let's create something new. Like at that moment, 18 years ago, a lot of things moved in the States, around the world. Belgium, Europe was a little bit changing, but not a lot. So I thought, let's make something new and create it with the idea to create new beers. And what I mean with new beers is when I went to China and I tasted the perfect Belgian triple, or nearly perfect Belgian triple, brewed by an Australian guy in a hotel. And then I suddenly discovered that the recipes are traveling, ingredients are traveling. So suddenly it was not that you had to be in Belgium to drink a decent Belgian beer. Suddenly you had the same flavor experience in other places. And then when I stopped looking into it, I noticed that people start using the same malt, the same yeast, the same composition sometimes due to sharing and recipes. So the idea came up to create my own ingredients, which was specialty malt, which has got a historical background in Belgium. And I started looking into it to come to the idea to say, let's focus on making specialty malts to create my own beers with it. That was actually, it was a push came from traveling, by seeing people in the States, people seeing in China, people seeing everywhere. And then I had the idea, if I want to be Belgium and I want to do something in the future, which is still special at the Belgium, I need to create my own fingerprint as an artist kind of thing.
Yeah. So you were already traveling, and then you wanted to future-proof your concept, what you want to bring out, and then you came by malt.
Yeah. So actually for 10 years, I was making beer for the Aldi, the cheap. So actually I started with being a home brewer and then I became a brewer. And then for 10 years, I wasn't making craft beer. I was making like industrial level beer, big volumes. And for this project, I was involved to do commissioning and startup of a brewery in Suzhou in China, near Shanghai, during 2 years. And by doing this, you learn a lot. And life before that, I was brewmaster at Seminabus, where I also seen a lot. And then you start to notice, like, I want to go back to craft. You see what's worked around the world, you see what's inspired people. And at that moment, you've seen that the States, Belgian beer was, New Belgium was still like very hot. And I noticed they're making very great beer. They made very good stuff. And when I came back to Belgium every time, they say, like, yeah, Belgium, we have the best beer in the world, which is actually still okay, which is still great. But I started to ask my question, why are people drinking Belgian beer? Because it's good, because it's great, because it's a story. Mm-hmm. And then I noticed I wanted to add something new no one had before. For example, the guy in Shanghai who had his brewery, the Australian guy, he was importing malt from Belgium. He was buying yeast from the States to get everything combined. And then I was like, if I need to do something new flavor, new taste, I need to come up with something new. And that was specialty malts. That was the background, which got the background in history in Belgium as well. So it's making specialty malts was a historical thing.
Yeah.
Every brewery had its own malt house, and then everything became that people had or a malt house or a brewery. And I went back to say, let's make specialty malts, caramelize it, smoke it, burn it, toast it, and then to compose my own beers.
Yeah. Can you tell me a bit about the learning curve? I think a lot of people all here know a brewer, a craft brewer, a home brewer, and the difficulties of making your first brew and make it consist in taste. How is the learning curve with creating your own burnt malt?
Ah, for the creating curve, I need to get you go back to the start when I started brewing. When I was 18 years old, I started in home brewing, which is a long time ago. At that moment, only old people was doing home brewing. Home brewing was not popular at all. Craft or specialty beers was going down, kind of stabilizing a little bit. And then I met an old person. He was 72 years old. He wanted to learn me brewing. And in his life, he was selling roasters for coffee roasters. And he told me at that moment, he said like, yeah, Bert, roasting coffee, roasting malt with a coffee roaster, it's terrible. I tried it. It never worked. It was a disaster. You can do everything in your life, but never start making specialty malts because it's too difficult to do. Mm-hmm. And then for a while, I was brewmaster at Bohn.
Mm-hmm.
And one day Bohn told me, like in the past, making black malts in the past, it was so delicious, so wonderful. It's pity people cannot make the same malt anymore because it was freshly toasted. It was something you cannot buy anymore. It's not the same. And another conversation, he came up to say, like, look, Sam, he came up with the point that Rodenbach had his caramelization process in the past and that the flavor changed. It was also pity. Then in one history of my life, I found the recipe of Westvleteren when I worked at Semenardis. And then I noticed that I had some malts you cannot buy anymore. And then the interest came together like to say, look, if it wouldn't be wonderful to trying to master something nearly no one wants to touch anymore. People were saying it's too difficult, it's too complicated. And then I knew if I start focusing on something nearly nobody wants to focus on, then mm-hmm. I have a big chance to create special. And that was a push to go into specialty malt. Then I'm a brewing engineer from background in chemistry. So I learned everything about roasting, toasting, caramelization.
Okay.
But when I came to the point about home making specialty malts, I basically closed the book. And the idea was from the beginning, let's make everything incredible, wonderful, not perfect, but consistent. So the logic I'm keeping doing is saying create something new, but not exactly the same. And that's a pity thing which is happening in brewing sometimes. People are using the same websites, going through the same other compositions, because they found it somewhere on the internet. They found the same book, same websites, same composition. And then you get into the line of people saying IPA should taste like this, and IPA should taste like that, a beer should taste like this, like that. And then, for example, a beautiful beer, which is to be inconsistent, to be consistent, not perfect, is a New England IPA, for example. It's a new trend. It needs to be hazy, need to be something different. And that was the same logic I did with my malt, with my beer, to say, let's make something which is from my fingerprint. Don't look to the books anymore. Learn what you've learned before and then create something new. Stop watching to the internet. Stop watching to what other people do. And then develop something I had to do. And that's the thing. The roaster is not a typical roaster. It's an exactly wrong roasting system. But because it's exactly wrong, I can create something unique. That's the logic.
Yeah. Tell me a bit about your background. What did you study exactly?
So originally, I wanted to become a chef when I was 16. And at the end, I became a chemical engineer, biochemistry, specialization in brewing. So it was which is a combination of chemistry, cooking, chef, physics, everything combined. So I finished that in Ghent. Then I became a free student in Leuven. And when I was in Leuven, I worked for InBev University and at InBev for 4 months. Then I went to New Belgium Brewing for 4 months. I came back from the States. I was brewmaster at Bohn and cellar master at Bohn. Then I became brewmaster at Semenardus. Then actually I quit my job to become an engineer for making French fries, Belgian fries, frozen fries. A twist in mind, so I was like, do something new. So I resigned my job. In the same week I resigned my job, I was job offered in Alaska. It was one offered in a malt house, and it was a request to go to Brooklyn Breweries in the States to start up a bottling line. So with them at that period, I started up local one. It was the first fermentation beer in the fermentation the bottle at Brooklyn Breweries. That's something I did with them. And then in the same period, I get a phone call from Martens from Limburg to move to their place to start up a brewery, help the startup of a brewery of 3 million hectos, which is still the biggest owned brewery in Belgium, which is not from InBev. And then I went to China for them. Then I went to Romania for them. Then I came back to Belgium, started my own business. Then in the same period, I started building a brewery for Froselis in Austin. Then I picked up a project to build a brewery in South Africa. at the end, a guy in Austin, he told me, Bert, you should build your own systems. Then I designed a system for them. Then I built one brewery in Ghent. And now at the moment, I'm in a project to build a brewery in El Paso, doing one in Belgium. And yeah, but things are going quiet again due to COVID. So in the last 20 years, I think what I did in the last 20 years, what normal people do in 2 lives. So I just taking some more relaxed time during COVID and to see where it's getting to. But I've done enough at the moment.
Yeah, it's a quite an impressive palmarès already.
Yes, it's much better.
And tell me, is it then you also design the plans, or is it like we have already the plans, the engineers and the study bureaus already calculated most of the things, but they need hands-on people to execute it and to
Everything.
supervise it?
Everything. So the two projects like South Africa was basically you and another project in the States. People give you a phone call and say, we want to build a brewery. And actually I design everything from A to finish. So doing the engineering from pipeline layouts, purchasing equipment, designing, sizing until the software development. It's a total turnkey solution. So
My.
from another project in the States, I moved the brewery from Seattle to New Orleans, then re-engineered to Hill Brewery, Pimtehol Brewery. For the brewery in South Africa, I purchased copper kettles in Belgium, shipped it to South Africa, designed to the engineer the brewery, which is all brickwork, copper kettles, cool ship, everything. So it's actually helping to build dreams for people,
Yeah, cool.
full breweries. So to full set.
Yeah, my yeah, impressive. And during those days, you were living abroad most of the time, or?
Let's 2019, 2020, I 2018, 2019, I was 180 years, I was 180 days outside the country. I made a calculation in 2018. I flew something like 10 times around the world. In 2019, I had 2.5 months in a row a jet lag, and which was yeah. It's actually honestly, I when COVID started, my body gave some payback time. so I had to really slow down, and I had to slow down, which I'm still doing at the moment. Because you've been living on the limits for a while, but this is the first year in 8 years I'm having a full summer in Belgium, and it seems like the first time in 6 years I will notice what winter is in Belgium, because last year during the time I've been in Russia, I've been in Italy, I've been in South Africa, and I've been in China in the same period now, so. It's relaxing. It's a kind of relaxing time. COVID is like push back, dial back, back to zero,
If
and then.
you look to other college students with the same course as you, are all of them like more in the international scene of setting up breweries, or are you the exception?
We've been two in the class. We've only
Oh.
been with two in class, so it was very impressive during that time. So nobody, you need to imagine at that time, if two people followed the course, becoming a brewing engineer, you've been very very exceptional, and then becoming a brewmaster, it was like why do you want to become a brewmaster? And these days, people want to become a brewmaster, they want to become a brewer. Everybody starts to brew. But at that time, nobody was doing it. And let's say, for some reason, people started picking me up as being a yes man
Yeah.
and being the crazy guy who's saying, you want to build a brewery in Austin? Oh, yeah, why not? You want to build a brewery in South Africa? why not? You're doing something in China, let's go to China. One time I had a question request to build a brewery in North Korea. Actually, I said yes, but it never happened.
And you didn't?
No, it didn't happen. So the question came from indirectly from the South Korean government, who want to make a build, who want to build a relationship in North Korea. But the question came, and it it never happened. So fine. We'll see what's coming next. We'll see.
Yeah. And if we see to your own brewer here, so yeah, you don't have your own brewer installation, but you, like in the video you told, you outsourced the brewing of the beer to friended brewers. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. How is that? Any plans on making your own brewery on that, or is it that's a choice not to compete with your customers directly?
It's have been back and forth. It's been growing in like this. So, look, last year I was, if it travels so much time, you don't have the time anymore to have your own brewery, which is a kind of a problem.
Yeah.
Second thing is if you have your own brewery and you're a brewmaster, you have one big problem. And the problem is you know too much. So you immediately, I'm a kind of a perfectionist on that one. You just want to be perfect in what you're doing and being the best as a kind of a goal. So you don't want to get away with stupid cheap equipment. And I don't want to say people have been choosing for stupid cheap equipment. Sometimes people have been doing it, but then they start, they succeed because at that moment they don't know what kind of mistakes they've purchased. And they continue, and you can see a lot of brewmasters, they never start a brewery. It's very exceptional. You continue working in the brewery. So did I have plans? Yes. Did I have the plans a few times? Yes, I had plans a few times. Mm-hmm. Do I still have some hidden plans in my back of my head? Yes, I still have it. Will it ever happen? Maybe. But we'll see. Maybe one day I will see. These days it's difficult with COVID, so let's say most of the breweries, they're selling much less beer. So today to go to the market and let's look for investors, it's impossible. I think the next 2 years will be very, very special 2 years to survive, to have your own business, to continue.
Yeah.
Okay, we'll see.
Yeah. What do you think? You said the C word a couple of times due to COVID. What will happen with smaller craft brewers? And let's focus a bit on the hardware. Will brewers more use cheaper hardware and stuff? Or will cheap brewers go out of business faster, investment-wise?
I think a lot of breweries and beer companies, whatever, are struggling a lot. Which is not—it's not shameful, not at all, because it's people are buying less, and this second wave in Belgium is much harder as the first wave. What will happen? You can see people who got big pockets and a lot of money. They will succeed, and they will have more money afterwards. Maybe they're gonna buy some brands. I don't know. But you can see if people struggle for a while, and the market restarts, they first want to make money back. So I'm kind of scared that people, before they invest again in new breweries, there will be a backlash. What I do think is people who never invested in breweries and who owns a brand and who don't own a brewery, I think they might become stronger in the next months because they didn't have the costs, they didn't waste money. And what I've noticed, some of them, they don't have a business and they are employees, and they are employees sitting at home, so they have all the time now to go to sales. So what's happening, I have no idea. I think nobody knows. I think some breweries will collapse, so people will grow. What I do know in China, so we have a lot of contact in China. China is growing their own markets at a very high speed. So they're building a lot of breweries in China at the moment. So what will it give? I know some Belgian brewers, they started to say, look, Asia is a new future. Let's sell a lot of beer to Asia. But I'm scared it's going to be the same like the States. In the beginning, they need you, they use you. And at the end, they make it by themselves. And I think China is getting to the same direction. That's my feeling.
I was talking with Kuhn from Hobbs & Moore about China recently, and he said also, yeah, China, the beer and craft beer there is not yet saturated, the market, the internal market there. So you can quite easy build a brewery because the hardware is cheap, labor cost is cheap, rent is high. Do you think that you really think that like after a couple of years they have the knowledge, they know how to brew, that they will
Last year,
compete with us in terms of export?
copy. So actually, no, they will not. I don't believe they will start sending a beer to Belgium. I don't think so. But there's indirect competition because if they start making themselves, why should they ship it from us? And what will happen is some very rich Chinese, they will still purchase from Belgium as being the very high level products met smaller volumes. You need to know when I was working in Suzhou, that was 6 years ago. Every year there was 650 or 750 brewmasters finishing their course. And you need to know when in China, before you become an engineer, you're the top of the crop. You're really good because like sometimes the people I've worked with, a welder in China, sometimes they can have a very high skilled level, but one moment in their life when they had to do a study at school, they failed that day because they've been sick, so they ended up becoming a welder, but they are top. So if you work with engineers in China, these guys are really good. The only problem they got, they're not creative, so they still have the push to copy. But if you ever been to China is moving like crazy. It's every year, they are 2 steps ahead. If you went to China 10 years ago, people drive like crazy, like nuts. When I was there last year, people nicely drove in their own lanes. Everything was clean, everything was nice. People have been friendly, don't spit on the ground anymore. So yeah, China is growing. It's a crazy market. So will they compete? Yes, in the way we will need to sell less to them. What you also see at the moment that they're getting more money, so they have less, they're losing less money at the moment, I think. What we noticed from the Chinese, they have a vaccine, so people getting vaccinated in China, which is weird for us because we don't see it on the news, but we get the news from the Chinese every day now. Yeah, we're getting vaccinated, we are fine, we are healthy, no problem. So yeah, things are moving quick for me, for them, for everyone, so we'll see. We'll see what happens.
What are the big challenges that a medium small brewer has when he wants to develop his brewery? What are the bottlenecks in terms of installation?
Ha, it's a different bottlenecks. One of the major bottlenecks a brewer got is he forgot to sell. He forget to sell. And what I sometimes see, not always, is a lot of people want to build a brewery because they are passionate, really passionate. And then you sometimes ask the question, how will you be able to grow? How will you be able to make sales? And that's the biggest challenge. So some people have never thought really good about how to distribute, how to make sales, or they've been thinking too much in a very small area. For example, they've been making direct deliveries to bars, to pubs. They made good profit on that one. And then they suddenly grow to a certain level. They need to notice that they need to make the deliveries, all the deliveries by themselves. And then they sometimes suddenly go to new kind of reality. And reality who sucks because they don't make so much margin anymore. What I also see in the last 3 years is there's so many beers in the market that, like importers, they have the luxury to start to choose. They know that a lot of people want to buy, they want to sell, so the price negotiations are getting more much harder as it was 5 or let's say 6 years ago, because there's so many beers on the market.
So your perfect brewery, you need to calculate that you have to sell bigger volumes instead of expanding your installation after 1 or 2 years and need to borrow extra money for that.
You need to choose what you want to be. That's a question I've Always going to discussion with people. When I the brews I built always have been kind of customized with the client, and always with the direction: what do you want to be? What's your goal? What's your purple goal? You want to be local? Well, then be local. You want to be the biggest in the world? Be the biggest in the world. Be sure you have biggest pockets.
You also built small breweries, because when we talked about your portfolio, I thought very big breweries, international ones, but you also
10 hectares. We're building one now, at the moment, one of 5 hectares. At the moment, I'm doing one of 5. Then we have products running with 10. In the States, it's a brewery at the moment who are going to do like 30,000 barrels a year. So I'm doing from really small to big. I don't care. I care, but it's helping to people to build their dream. That's the thing. If people are saying, I have 5 hectares and I want to buy from China the cheapest brewery, well, then go to China, fix it yourself. That's the kind of thing. I cannot compete with being the with everyone. But if people say we want to have a decent equipment, who want to do more as other people are able to do in a brewery, then we will guide them to the finish. So sometimes it's guiding people, sometimes it's developing a whole plant, sometimes it's the layout. Like the other breweries I've built is like, every time is, if you want to make a tour in the brewery, how will the tour like? How will the experience of the brewery be? Yes. So if you come in, if you make a tour, it will just, these are the vessels, no, like the one in El Paso, it's with the platform, and they want to have a pole like for firemen, so he can glide down. And another brewery I've built, you walk around, you see the lab, you see the bottling line on a high level. The one from South Africa is really great with the architects. We took angles that you can look in the brewery, you can see the copper kettle, you can see the cool ships. So they're having weddings in the brewery. Just because it's like a beauty factor. So it's a brewery, or you build a machinery, and then it can look ugly like shit, as long as it's efficient. But the other thing is, you want to build an experience, and experience is something else as just building a brewery. It's how do we make a tour, what's the background? Like when I've built Seelis in Austin, I studied all the books from Pierre Seelis to understand why did he make this beer, what is the background? And then to go back to the recipe to say, let's do things in the recipe, which are typical Belgium, which is unique. You can find it in the States. So people get an experience. That's important. Yeah. It's not only about beer.
Yeah, it's really a full package that you offer then. How big is the band in terms? Is it only you that people hire, or you have your trusted employees?
So I'm small and big. So I got 2 employees at the moment. Then I have an engineer, an architect who is living in South Africa. The nice thing is, this guy was building castles in the past. So if you want to make something beautiful, we can do. He was really designing castles and every details. If you want to have a door designed, a lamp, a customized bar, he will design it together. Then I have suppliers. In South Africa, in China, and in Belgium, software people in Ukraine, engineers in South Africa also. So I got a team of freelancers to do small projects up to very big projects. That's it.
Yeah, cool. How do you find great people?
Travel. Travel, easy. travel. Yeah, you travel and you meet good people. Then by the down the road you meet people you never want to work with again. Then you meet people you really want to work with. At this moment it's a mess. What I mean, and at this moment everything you're planning for is always nearly ending up in a very difficult thing these days. Due to COVID again, for example, if in months ago, last year, if you want to check a machine, you just flew to the machine. You're discussing with engineers. Okay. You've been there for 1 week, you come back. If you wanted to schedule a container to ship a boat, to ship a container last year, let's say 3 days in advance, you just say, I want to put something in a container, and the container was moving around. And what is happening these days, people are not aware about it, but at this moment, at this today, not in 2 months, nearly all the containers are in Europe. So if you want to ship something from China to Europe, they have no containers. And then the containers who need to come to Europe, there's nearly no place because people start to overbid themselves. And so there have been what they call blind sailing. So last month, there have been boats with empty containers going to China or opposite to have this business going. So at the moment, it's a total mess to business with everyone. So things you've done in 4 months aren't currently done in 6 months. Even shipments, which was done in 4 to 5 weeks, at this moment, boats are making like 16 stops in between to be high profits.
Yeah.
So today, it's having an international team is wonderful, but it's the same moment, it's difficult.
Yeah.
But I've been used to communicate with Zoom, with all this kind of stuff before, so that's nice.
So you really have your modern online community of freelancers where you work with, but the supply chain is still totally messed up.
Totally, it's for everyone. Even people in Belgium, sometimes you're buying people buying components. If I'm doing business, for example, in the States, we need to purchase cooling equipment for them. And they also mentioned like, yeah, we have problems. Or like a cutting line. They say, yeah, we think we can deliver in 10 weeks, but it might be as well 14 weeks. Because maybe 2 or 3 components are coming from some other point who are going into lockdown.
Yeah.
Then the office go into lockdown, people go into quarantine. When you go into quarantine, I was in quarantine with my kids the last 5 days. So you can imagine it's not the best day to be very efficient in doing business. So you're getting delays on your emails getting delays, people getting delayed. So it's an interesting time.
Yeah. Did you notice in the beginning of the Trump era, the the financial war with China for the metal? Did that impact the prices of brewery installations and shipping and papers?
Yeah. So the only thing that's happened is that the final customer is just paying the bill. So. So import taxes of a kettle or a tank to China is 25% import tax. But what's happening if the import of tanks went up to 25%, the stainless steel, which is purchased by the tank builder in the States, also went up to 25%. And then the American made manufacturers, they also went up with the price for 20%. So at the end, who've been paying for this additional custom cost? It was a brewer, no one else. The Chinese still sold equipment. There was some delay, but not so much as everyone was thinking, not at all. Even if I import tanks to the States, big tanks, I'm still 20% cheaper and I'm still making profit. So it's got a war. The war is going on, still going on, but at the end, it's about money. And people are saying American first, but if they suddenly can buy a watch or a phone which is made in China, they still buy it. An Apple is still made in China, and still people are going to buy it. They will not say, let's buy a smartphone made in the States, because I don't think there are even smartphones which exist, which are based in the States, built in the States. So the trade work is still going on. What I do know is that the Trump has more influence on the sales of Belgian beers, because he had really the influence of American first. And people also get a reaction, why should we buy import beers? Why we have great local beers? And like last week, I believe 2 weeks ago, a big importer from Belgian beers in the States went bankrupt due to COVID, but also due to the last years, people said, why should I buy a Belgian triple coming from Belgium if I can buy a local brewed Belgian triple, which is 25% cheaper, which is local, which is American, and yeah, let's support Belgium. Let's support the States, don't support the Belgians. So the Trump has more influence as only the stainless steel.
Yeah.
It's a mentality change.
Yeah, true. If we look to my private sector a bit, information technology, where is that in brewing installations? You mentioned software development in Ukraine already. Is there a lot that software and technology can help to make a brewery more efficient, more lean, and better in quality? Or did we already reach the top with measurements and parameters and laboratoria?
Oh,
and
not
that's
enough.
It?
Totally not. So I think on that point we still have when I worked in the big companies, they're getting on a very good track. The challenge is only there are two challenges. You have the software which is getting better and better and better and better. But then I also noticed people are still scared about software because you still want to understand something. And you need to know brewing is a very simple thing. And what I noticed, for example, loitering, if it's simple, people understand. It's easy. The loitering is getting blocked and people know if I push that button, I add some water, I mix it again, it's solved. But if you got physiologic, which is very logic and so fuzzy, and your loitering starts to do things you don't understand anymore, you can see people getting out of the comfort zone. And I do believe in software for breweries. I firmly believe it's a good thing if it can keep people in their comfort zone that they're still under control. And it's the same thing like with cars. Cars who are driving by themselves, people are scared about it. And it's a similar thing with breweries. If breweries starts to behave like a robot and they're doing their own stuff, it's getting scared. And then if you know that a lot of people start brewing because it's their passion and they want to become a brewer before they go to fully automated, maybe it takes 10 years because they're getting more and more experienced and more like into the engineering step and again into production, they get used to it, then it's getting better. But I do believe there's still a lot of things to do in automation to help the brewer. To integrate quality into an automation, to like also know for in the States, like saturation of beer, they have new technology with software who's counting the amount of CO2 which is added. Things 5 years ago it will be too expensive to do, but today you can see this technology is entering into breweries as well. So it's moving, but you need to know this thing. Breweries are not the most high level technological environment in the world. Totally not.
Yeah.
We are simple.
Okay. And tell me, in terms of stock management, is there a lot of software that is automated already? Automated warehouses, but that's mostly outsourced, I think, in breweries.
That's mostly it's outsourced. There is some the higher level software in breweries. They have like a management stock management in it. If you have the accountant, sometimes the accountant programs already got it. There is some new software on the market who's also doing the customs. And then you have some companies who starts to do the logistics for all the breweries as well. That's also out there. But is it a lot of software that sometimes is just an Excel sheet, I think, and you just add plus and you add minus. And the difficult thing in brewing is making the prediction how much you need to brew,
mm-hmm.
and finding your trends. To say I need to brew this amount of volume because I'm expecting this growth in the next months. And you need to plan in advance, and that's maybe some tools which will help to the brewery that they can plan in advance, not like on a paper with estimations that you can say, look, I got this beer, this schedule. If I brew on that moment, that's as my stock behavior over the next months. I think that's something which is useful. I've seen this things made by breweries, bigger breweries in Excel by themselves, but this might be like useful for breweries, a stock management over time, not only today. We're saying look, 6 weeks, 4 weeks, mm-hmm. and it's happening.
Yeah, so more a prediction system that takes trends and data. Let's say there is a lot of demand for beer A on the internet in the world or online, offline. It picks it up and then it warns like, hey, you might get maybe extra sales, so start to brew extra.
Or like, for example, last year in My Heaven was selling most in June, for example. You need to prepare for June. What software which should be very useful is for importers, that importers can actually look in your stock, that they have a kind of direct access that they can see, look, this beer is coming at that moment. This is in the pipeline. This is the status of your beer. We expected this. And now the importer is more sending an email like, what do you got on stock? What is coming? If they had access to your own stock and they see like, look, they have so much bottles of Heaven, Hell, Full Moon on stock. in this package. This will, next batch will be available. It will be good for both, because otherwise make an order of 150 kegs. And if they knew from their side that you only have 50 kegs on stock and you didn't have any brews scheduled, they will help with you to say, ah, look, guy, we're planning to make, we're planning to make sales of Full Moon, for example, on big batches. Just be sure that you brew on time. And I think that's communication between supplier and customer, which you sometimes see in chain and exchange of information between companies who's doing supply chain to supermarkets. Sometimes supermarkets, they can also look directly into the stock. This might be useful for importers, that they can see how much do you got in stock, what is predicted, what is coming up, what is your schedule, when do you think you're going to brew the seasonals. And this might be a very good communication for people to see what's coming, because it's also interest to see, oh, you suddenly have a new beer. No, in that moment, they will know in advance, you will have a beer on that data, on that schedule, with that information. I believe that's, got a kind of a benefit. But again, to implement it, to do it, it sounds easy, but sometimes it's not so easy.
Indeed. Right, tell me a bit about your own beers, your brewery, how, your brewery, your maltery. We saw it in the video, it's not that automated. What are the...
No, it's basic. On purpose.
What are the first, like the next steps that you're gonna do with your maltery? Are you gonna change anything about the setup?
No. So the malt rose was purchased to be basic as hell, because I'm small business. So I was like, if I can, if it breaks, I will be able to fix it with a hammer and smash it if necessary. So it's all stupid material. It's manual, so it's still a small business. So it's got the kind of fun to taste, to smell, to roast when you look at the change of the colors. Let's say I'm still in that phase of being passionate about flavor and everything. When I became too more automated, I can say you put some automation on it and it runs automatic, doing all the temperature steps by himself. So what's coming in the next weeks, together with a kombucha brewery, we created a bombucha, which is kombucha made with my freshly roasted malt, which is giving a very beautiful result. Then next products we are working on doing, I got time now, is to making pralines. Chocolate, which is every time matched with malt I've roasted, which is giving very good results as well. Then I've created a coffee. So you need to know the background of Guinness is a little bit like roasting barley to make a cheap coffee, because it was a war. And if you roast malt and you blend it with coffee, you also have a great flavor. And then during the tastings in the last year in my malt bakery, people always taste the malt and saying, oh, it's tasting delicious. This will be wonderful to make a granola with. So now I'm on the last steps to finish my bombola, which is a granola. So it's more like, it was in my business plan 8 years ago to say, I got my malt. It's good to make beer, but you can also make all the great stuff with malt. Yeah. And that's getting finished now. A coffee, a granola, just to let people taste about malts, to experience something new and more. And I will see where I get. Might be a total fuck up, might be great, might be good, we'll see. I have no idea these days.
Cool. Looking very forward to that, to try the coffee. All right, thanks a lot.
But the kombucha is wonderful. It's alcohol free. And the acidity with the malt, it's giving a kind of goose kind of touch to it. Okay. It's really good. Yeah.
Okay. And when will it be ready?
2 weeks.
2 weeks. When this video is released.
just 1 hour before the video was released, I tasted the Belgian Oak 2020. So that's coming on the market in the next 10 days. That's coming to the market as well. So in the next months, the Bling Bling is revamped to be a new type of IPA. Belgian Oak is coming, so we're on the move again. Let's see what's coming.
And we're gonna add a link in the description below for you guys. All right, thanks a lot.
Okay, thanks.
Bye bye. Thanks a lot.